America's most exciting radio magazine. Stay tuned for more.
Singing in the rain, what a glorious feeling. I'm happy again.
Hello, this is Sunny Chayes, and you're listening to KCLA 99.3, Singing in the Rain. And I am singing in the rain today because it is an awesome day. And the Nepal project that we have been talking about for the last two shows is full steam ahead. So the sustainable water, the money for schools, and the film crew that's going to be covering all of this is in gear, happening, and so I will keep you posted on that. I also want you to know that I was invited to Marianne Williamson's lovely abode to discuss her latest Heart and Soul project, the LA event that's going to be on November 10th and 11th at the Saban Theater called Sister Giant. And in this show and next week, I'm going to be playing part one and part two of our conversation. And I'm really pleased to be able to support Marianne and promote her effort to put a flag in the ground, gather citizens and giants in the world of political, spiritual, and progressive thought. The ideas of more women running for office, how women can become more deeply involved in American politics, the support we need, and why women's presence and voice is so critical at this time, and so much more will be presented. The questions, the answers, the reasons, the possibilities. Yes, new consciousness, new politics. Yeah, my hope is that after you hear Marianne Williamson and her passion about this subject, you will join us at Sister Giant in person or live streaming. Also, you can go to Marianne's webpage and hear Eva Longoria's endorsement of Sister Giant, as well as a list of presenters. And I want to give you a bio a bit on Marianne for the five of you out there who don't know who she is. Marianne Williamson has been a spiritual activist, lecturer, and author extraordinaire for many years. Most of her astonishing books have been New York bestsellers, including the mega seller, A Return to Love. Other titles include The Age of Miracles, Illuminata, Illuminated Prayers, Imagine, which I'm reading right now, The Gift of Change, Enchanted Love, A Woman's Worth, Healing the Soul of America, which I'm also reading, The Everyday Grace, Emma and Mommy Talking to God, A Course in Weight Loss, and more books. Marianne founded Project Angel Food in the 80s, and it's continuing now, which supports homebound AIDS patients with food and love. Founder of the Peace Alliance, a grassroots campaign supporting legislation currently before Congress to establish a United States Department of Peace. How amazing is that? Among so many of the beautiful global contributions, too numerous to mention, she has also brought her elegant and brilliantly articulate presence as a popular guest on television programs such as Larry King Live, Good Morning America, Charlie Rose, The Howard Stern Show, and Politically Incorrect. Marianne had many profound and moving moments while being a guest on Oprah. The love continues because a new endeavor for Marianne Williamson will be was actually the weekly radio show Oprah and Friends, which airs on XM Radio. So let's check that out. So we are going to break to a commercial just for a quick moment. When we come back, we will have Marianne with us. So stay tuned.
Snowman, there was snow on the ground. Right in front of my apartment door was this bum wearing a t-shirt, freezing to death. So I step around him and I walk in. I think, great, already a lousy day, now this. And then I get this sick feeling over me. It's like, forget me, what about this guy? So I go to my closet and I take out this sweater and this coat I haven't worn since college. And I thought about giving it to him, and I stood there feeling dumb. I mean, was he gonna be mad at me because I gave him my hand out? I mean, he's freezing to death. I open my door and I gave him the clothes. He puts them on, he stares at me, and he walks away. I don't know. I mean, it was weird, but it was good. I mean, you don't have to be the Salvation Army to give somebody a coat.
Bart Darris is one of the little answers to the big problems facing every community in America. And because there are more people than problems, things will get done. All you have to do is something. call the Points of Light Foundation at 1-800-677-7309. Do something good. Feel something real.
I am so thrilled and honored and pleased to have with us today the great and amazing and beautiful and hot Marianne Williamson. I think one of the things that's so cool about you is that you make everything so relevant and now, and you kind of shake us up and wake us up and have us really think about things in such a deep way. And just everything I said in your intro is just so, so true. So
thank you.
You're
right
so
back
welcome.
At you, by the way.
Thank you. So let's get to it. Let's get to it. So I want to talk first of all about Sister Giant and what is your idea about doing it and why did you want to do it? And let's start there.
A couple of years ago, I did an event called Sister Giant, Waking the Sleeping Giant of American Womanhood. And I took three films. One was called The Burning Times, which was made by the Canadian Film Board in their spirituality and, Women in Spirituality series. The second film we used was a dramatic special with Hilary Swank and Angelica Houston, made by HBO several years ago, called Iron-Jawed Angels. Mm. And the third one is the Abigail Disney film called Pray the Devil Back to Hell. And the first one, being the Burning Times, is about the burning of the so-called witches during the Middle Ages when up to 600,000 or 800,000 women were burned at the stake. The second one is about the women's suffragette movement here in the United States. And the third one is about the extraordinary work of the women of Liberia during the Civil War there several years ago. And I felt that the three films together told an important narrative. First was what suggests an almost cellular memory among Western women of a time when we were punished greatly for speaking our minds. Because if you look at the sheer number of not only Western women, but certainly even American women, where we are 51% of the most powerful nation on earth, we should be a moral force. When you think of some of the heinous things that happen on the planet, 17,000 children dying of hunger every single day, starvation, the billion people who live on the planet on less than $1.25 a day, those living in what's called deep poverty. The truth is that if American women among ourselves simply decided that this should not be, then in ways most of us do not realize, it would not be. And yet we are relatively quiet about some of the things that matter most. Martin Luther King said, your life begins to end on the day you become quiet. You become silent about things that matter most. And then with the third film, which was the Pray the Devil Back to Hell, it was an opportunity for us as Americans to look at the extraordinary work being done by women in Africa, women in the Middle East, women who have a fraction of our resources, a fraction of our power, a fraction of our freedoms, and who stand up to truth and speak truth to power and change their communities and their systems in a way that I believe brings up for most of us, should we look at those things, a kind of healthy shame. What are we doing? So it was a wonderful weekend, and in between the movies, I had hired professors and speakers who would talk about the actual historical phenomenon, give people a chance to ask questions. And then we capped off the weekend with presentations by an organization I'm on the board of called Results, results.org, which is an organization that is one of the primary anti-hunger and anti-poverty lobbies here in the United States. You know, after I do something like that, then people say, well, let's do this in this town or in that town. But that's not the kind of person I am. I sort of kick the door open, and then it goes where it goes. But after a couple of years, I felt moved to try to take a next step. And that is that where I see American women right now, I don't think Americans in general, particularly after 9/11, need so much to be awakened. A lot has happened. People aren't living in quite the stupor that I think we were in during the 80s and the 90s regarding so much unnecessary human suffering and regarding so many of the very serious stress points on the planet. However, it's one thing to be awakened, to have your eyes opened. It's another thing to take action. And I think what's happened over the last few years is that many of us have become activists. Many people are involved with NGOs, nonprofit organizations, and so forth. However, for very understandable reasons, given its toxicity and its mean-spiritedness and its basic corruption, many of the best and brightest among us, the most conscious among us, and certainly women, look at electoral politics and say, I don't want to go there. Mm-hmm. And I think the primary motivation for me in actually saying, let's get together one weekend, share our molecules, as the Course in Miracles says, an idea grows stronger when it is shared, had to do with something that happened for me several months ago when I was giving a talk at Stanford University. And during the day of the night of the talk, they very kindly gave a luncheon in my honor. And around 25, I think, of their best, most wonderful female students, undergraduate and graduate, who were involved in social justice, human rights, wonderful work, went around the table and were telling me who they are and what they do and what they plan to do when they leave Stanford. Mm. And to a person, they spoke of this extraordinary education they were getting, these extraordinary things they're doing. And then when they spoke of what they intend to do when they leave, the majority of the women said, when I leave here, I want to do, and the phrase was, policy and or advocacy work.
Hmm, interesting.
Not one of them said, become a senator, become a congressman, or become president. In other words, and this is what I brought up, I'm not sure it was very appreciated to a certain extent, I pointed out what I saw as the elephant on the table. In other words, in a world where we have recreated a kind of aristocratic archetype, call it corporatocracy, plutocracy, whatever, in which through years and years of accumulated policy shifts that take the material resources of our country and through tax breaks and corporate subsidies, allow that money to be more and more concentrated in the hands of a very few at the expense of the many.
Mm-hmm.
As Louis Brandeis said, you can have great amounts of money concentrated in the hands of a very few, or you can have democracy, you cannot have both. And we, of course, now have 1% of Americans controlling 40 or 42% of our wealth. In a world where basically moneyed interests take what they want, and then when they've taken basically what they want, the rest is just allowed to drop like crumbs onto the floor. In today's America, to say I want to do policy or advocacy work means basically I want to help make the decisions about how we divvy up the crumbs.
Absolutely.
Which means that at a certain level, no matter how much we work fundraising for candidates, working on advocacy and activism, we are doing not that much higher level work than getting the coffee.
It's
unless
true.
We ourselves are willing to move beyond the audacity of hope and the audacity of activism to the audacity to wield power. And I had seen, interestingly enough, I first saw it on Twitter, something about the Women's Campaign School of Yale University. And I thought, wow, there are campaign schools for women? I have since learned there are many, but I didn't know that at the time. I called up, and synchronistically, and as we know these things happen in a self-organizing universe, the woman who heads the Women's Campaign School for Yale University was reading one of my books at the time. And I just fell in love with her, Patty Rousseau. We started talking. I felt like we were girlfriends the first 5 minutes. I said, well, I can't come out there for a week. She said, come out for a day. And I thought to myself when I did that there are too many women I know who think, I want to change the world. I am willing to do almost anything. But either I wouldn't go towards politics because it's too toxic, or I wouldn't even know how. Mm-hmm. And both of those need to be addressed now. Mm-hmm. In terms of the toxicity, listen, I don't want to go become the stereotypic political type either in terms of electoral politics. There's too much there that is kind of a box we don't want to have to stuff ourselves into, mm-hmm. saying only what we think is okay to say and politically okay to say in order to win or whatever. But you can't transform what we don't engage.
That's it.
So I thought, well, let's recreate the conversation. And let's expose ourselves a little to what the political life in terms of electoral politics even means. So, you know, I don't have a Mecca complex about any aspect of my work, including this weekend. No one weekend is going to change everything. No one person's work is going to change everything. But I do believe that something very powerful happens when we share molecules. That line from the Course in Miracles, an idea is stronger when it's being shared. And that's the value of what's happening in the world right now. This radio show is an example. Mm-hmm. Facebook is an example. Twitter is an example. A new conversation now has a way to emerge. But if we are enthralled by the idea that what the sort of Democratic and Republican political machinery with its kind of chokehold on the American democratic process says, this is the political conversation, and we go, oh, okay, mm-hmm. when so many millions of us feel in our hearts, none of the above. That's not the story that fills my heart. That's not my earnest and heartfelt connection to the great narrative of possibility that is America at its best. Then it's time for us to come together and create a new conversation, which I believe is the true legacy of the great narrative of American possibility and politics. So, I have that kind of personality. Hi, Judy. Hi, Mickey. Let's do it. How about November? You know,
let's go to the bar.
I've always had that. I don't know. But it's worked so far, actually.
Quite. By the way, one thing that I want to say about that is that, I mean, it's a new time. It's a new day. It's a new paradigm. And we had politics in this country, and the Bill of Rights, and what was set up originally was awesome. I mean, it actually amazes me how long it has lasted with technology and just so much change that's happened, that in many, many aspects of our government and the United States of America and all that totally rocks. And yet, it is a new day. We need a new paradigm. And I am, you know, voting for you to do this, and that's why we're doing this show, because I absolutely believe that we have women have an energy of conciliatory compassion, and not all women, of course, like, you know, just like not all men don't have the nurturing energy, you know. So I think it's the best would be to bring all of the energies together, obviously. And it's like sort of the Republicans have kind of the dad energy, and the Democrats have sort of the mom energy, and coming together, if that could ever really work together, or then bringing together the new child that would be awesome to birth right now, or just allow to be. And what you're doing by bringing this conversation forward is it's like, wow, yeah, why not? I think a lot of people may not have ever thought of it. When I was reading your information about doing this weekend, it was like, yeah, there may be women who never thought of running for something. Maybe they've run businesses, and they've run, you know, their families, and they've run, you know, amazing things in their life and organizations and stuff. And it's like, why not jump in and take it to the next level that's going to make a difference and just crack it open a little bit?
This conversation about new paradigm thinking, if you think about it, this new paradigm thinking has already emerged, and it has already transformed almost every aspect of our society. Mm-hmm. New paradigm thinking has transformed our ideas about business. It has transformed our ideas about medicine and healing. It has transformed our ideas in the arts, relationships, spirituality, and religion. The only place where, if you look at it, it can't get in is politics. Mm-hmm. And it's because politics, as it is now practiced in the United States, with this chokehold of the Democratic and Republican machinery, doesn't allow for real new thinking. And what you said is so true. The irony, the dark irony here, is that America at its best, the Bill of Rights, as you mentioned, the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, the Gettysburg Address, stands for possibility. Mm-hmm. It stands for a new conversation. Our country was born of a radically new conversation, repudiating the old order of the English ancient regime. That's what America is, and that's what America is at its best and always has been. It's not that we haven't made mistakes ourselves, but there have always been those who stood for the possibility of self-correction, stood for the possibility of another way, stood for the possibility of an infinite possibility. Now you see that extraordinary American spirit, which is exceptional, the idea, and you see it transforming everything except politics. What an irony. And it's in politics where this new paradigm thinking, which has already emerged, it's already, many of us are all into it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the very fact that you are doing this radio show, this is extraordinary. You no longer have to go through a huge corporate entity in order to have your own platform.
Amen.
I mean, that's amazing. But we need to look at the current political machinery and see that it represents a closed system. So if we want to be part of the political dynamic, we have to go through one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing in the Declaration of Independence or in the Constitution or in any of our great first principle documents that says there will be two major political parties and only them. As a matter of fact, in his farewell address, George Washington warned us against political parties. And throughout our history, in the narrative of great social justice movements, there has always been a vital third-party voice. Abolition came from a third party, the Abolitionist Party. Women's suffrage came from a third party, the Women's Suffrage Party. Social Security, oddly enough, came from the Socialist Party. So I think a lot of the new paradigm thinking now has to do with not wanting to get permission from either one of them.
Exactly.
And I think that that ability on our part will help revitalize both of them, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Well, they'll have to be much more accountable, and it's like, you know, you add somebody else to the room as some new energy, and it's
Hello.
Like everybody cleans up their act.
Thank you.
And they will. I feel that way. And I do have great hope for this country, and I you know, lived here all my life and traveled a lot, and I'm always happy to come back here. And I'm going to ask my engineer really quickly, how much more time do we have?
10
yes.
minutes.
Okay. So I want to say also that I think that the idea... No, but you're not going to run. Are you going to run for anything?
I don't know what I'm going to do in my future. You know, in A Course in Miracles, we're sort of trained to live as much as possible in the present.
Mm-hmm.
And what I felt and feel very guided to do is to help create this weekend where my goal, if I have a goal, is that women and men, too, who are there, will leave. And you said something a few minutes ago which absolutely spoke to this point. Women, particularly, we think in terms of possibility already. I could do anything I want to.
Mm-hmm.
But when we think of running for office, it's sort of not on the plate. We go, oh, I don't want to go there.
Mm-hmm.
I see that same impulse within myself.
Mm.
Oh, my God. Oh, it's so toxic. Oh, they would eat me up. Oh, it would be so embarrassing. Oh, it would be so humiliating. Oh, they marginalize you. Oh, they trivialize you. Oh, you couldn't be yourself. And yet, here I am proclaiming to everyone else, oh, but you can't let that stop you. So I don't feel I can live in integrity with this effort were I not to move through these same obstacles in terms of internal obstacles within myself. I think if I were to ever run, it would be in the same way I would propose that you run,
mm-hmm.
or any other woman, I would say, the issue is not that we become something else in order to gain political power, as the world now defines political power. The point is for us to develop for ourselves a new conversation, a politics of conscience, in which success lies in the fact that we're even doing it. And it's not so much like they say in AA, it's principle, not personality.
Mm-hmm.
It wouldn't just be about one woman or even five women, can we get them elected? No, we need a new dynamic, in which there are hundreds, if not thousands of women, certainly scores of women out there throughout the country, running, whether they choose to run as libertarians, justice, green, Democrats, Republicans, whatever, on a kind of platform that calls for a new bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
For love is the bottom line, refusing to shut up when people would trivialize us or mock us for that,
mm-hmm.
who unabashedly proclaim that it is humanitarian rather than economic principle that should order human civilization.
Mm-hmm.
And who, when told, well, that's simply naive, will respond fully, without apology, by saying that anyone who believes that we can do anything less than change that ordering principle, then move into a deep reverence for life, for the planet, for each other, and survive another 100 years, they're naive.
Mm-hmm.
That we are willing to say that. If we get to that point, and I believe in that principle of next indicated action.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not trying to push any rivers. I'm saying it's a beautiful act on all our part to simply entertain the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And then if we get to that point where we are collectively moved, and if enough of us say, I'm going to go out and proclaim that, and I'm going to run for office to the extent to which any of our hearts will move to do that, then to me that becomes the story, and that is the success. Whether anyone raises one or not, people are saying, have you heard about these women who are out there talking about how child poverty should be the thing we talk about first, and the poverty level, the 46 million is what we should talk about first, the 23.1% child poverty rate, which is second highest only to Romania among 35 developed nations of the world, that's what we should be talking about first. That the fact that 17,000 children die of hunger every day, or the threat to democracy that is Citizens United, that they're speaking from a level of heart and concern, that is the story, because that is the success already.
Mm-hmm.
If enough of us are doing that kind of thing with dignity and with elegance and with grace and with savvy, that's what I want Sister Giant to be. I want it to be an incubator for all of us, by which we might take the higher consciousness moves that we've already made in our heads and our hearts and in our lives, intersect it with a serious, savvy, sophisticated political conversation.
Mm-hmm.
What comes out of that for me, for you, or for anyone in a very real way is none of my business, but that we begin to have the conversation and engage it in depth. To me, that is the point here, and that's the point of Sister Giant.
Well, again, amen. I love it. And I think what this can do also is allow everyone who's involved, or just, again, to open up our minds to even having compassion for any elected official. I mean, even if they are a man, and also to kind of change the idea of the judgment of just every little thing that anyone has ever done, because I think that is what keeps people out of politics now. With the internet and all these ways of knowing if you didn't tip someone well at a restaurant, well, then that shows your character. It's like, oh my goodness. So it's like, well, really, but what is the messenger? I mean, what can that woman or man do? And again, being much more conscious about the idea of things like it costs less money to educate a person at Harvard than it does to put them in jail. These kinds of things that are a little bit backwards that we have, or a lot backwards.
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah, a little bit backwards. That's just my small attempt at sarcasm. I just think that the idea of this, and it can be. I was speaking to my cousin the other day. I have female relatives in politics, and I've had them since I was a little girl. And we had a conversation the other day, and we were talking about Sister Giant, and I said, are you coming? And you better be there. And she said, absolutely. And she said, but you know, with us, we never had the idea that we couldn't be anything, because we did have those models. We had women who were rocking it when we were 5, you know, and I'm much older than that now. So I grew up with that, and I know it's possible, and that's why I also have always looked at men politicians as, you know what, yeah, they may do this or that, but what are they good bringing to the table? You know, what is that they can do for us? And I think it keeps a lot of people out of politics when, you know, as you say, with this judgment and all of that. So I know that, because of how you are with your way, and when you plant a seed, it grows. I don't know, there's like, the universe loves you as a seed planter, because you are going to make this really happen. And one thing that I read in your book, that I absolutely love this book that you actually edited, Imagine, and you said in this book, it makes me cry, you were talking about how you had a dream about a long table, I read it as dining room table, and with all of these people at the table. And I think that you create this everywhere you go. You don't even know it, but there are dining room tables all over the world having conversations that you have brought up. And I'm getting the clip, but I really honor and love you and bless you for doing that. And I just am sure that Sister Giant is going to be a big dining room table, and we're just going to get down and change some stuff.
Well, I thank you, and I hope, I want to throw the ball right back at you. I hope you yourself will consider being one of the women at the table. because you are an example, and I'm meeting so many right now. Why not you?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's interesting, you have family and politics, etc. You're exactly the kind of woman that I look at, this whole sister giant, you know, time for us to be big.
Mm-hmm.
When you said to me, what about me? I would say to you, what about you? And I think at a certain point, there are going to be a lot of us looking at each other, I will if you will.
Exactly. So now we are going to be going out to dancing in the streets as we always do. And so we'll be dancing in the streets at Sister Giant. And I just, again, everyone, I'm going to quickly say, how do they get at the show?
Okay.
At the event.
The event itself will take place in Los Angeles, November 10th and 11th. But there is live streaming available.
Mm.
So we're doing this 3 days after the presidential election. Because the way I look at it, no matter who wins, we need to talk. Mm-hmm. No matter who wins after this election, we need a new story. And so that's number one. It will be on that weekend at the Saban Theater in Los Angeles, but people can live stream from anywhere. So if you go to sistergiant.com, go to the registration page. It is eminently affordable. It's only a suggested donation, $50 for the whole weekend, suggested donation, $25 for students, and $35 live streaming. And if anyone can't afford that, we'll work with them. So
my goodness,
there's really kind of no excuse.
Okay, girls, let's get it together here and join Marianne. And I just think it's so awesome that you have, again, laid out this picnic blanket for us to all get on and get it happening. So again, this is 99.3 KCLA, Sunny Chase, and we're going to be dancing in the streets. Do you dance, Marianne?
I do dance.
Oh, cool.
Usually not while others are watching.
Okay, well, bye-bye for now. I am so grateful.